this little phone, we're now checking them 85 times a day. One out of every five waking and productive hours is spent on our devices. One out of every five waking and productive hours are on our devices. We're carrying supercomputers in our pockets. So to talk about how we're going to use those and how they're playing in campaigns south of the border and here north of the border, I first want to introduce a lady who was cool long before it was cool to be in media. She was a Much Music VJ, much less a political candidate, much less a digital director for campaigns, and now has evolved into a role as the head of public affairs for Twitter Canada. Please welcome Jennifer Hollett. Thank you. Saoirse Rockford has come across the pond to talk to us about the mobilizing platform that everyone's using, the campaign in a box that people use to track, to record, to communicate, to manage. It's called Nation Builder. Saoirse Rockford, ladies and gentlemen. And finally, to get some perspective from south of the border, someone who's worked on campaigns of the big names we all watch on television every night when we're screaming at the television at these panelists, the great digital content and the big scale campaigns we all dream of working on, he's the digital director for Senator Rand Paul, Vincent Harris. So we're going to start by giving each panelist about 5 minutes to give opening remarks and their perspective on how you use digital. If you're giving feedback online to folks, I guess the question we keep wanting to ask, and I'll share it with panelists, is how do we take the online offline? How does all of this digital, whether or not it's organizing, whether or not it's coordinating a campaign, whether or not it's working at one of the most exciting platforms right now in the world that's changing politics potentially with some folks south of the border who I'm not going to say their names, how does it come into the real world? How does it matter on election day? So I'm going to go to the far end of the panel first and work backwards. So the south of the border perspective, the man I introduced last, I'll let go first. Tell us about where is digital real and what are you doing differently south of the border?
Cool. Well, I appreciate everybody being here. It's my third year here at the Manning Conference. I love coming up here. It's a wonderful conference and it's... Thank you. And it's great to see a lot of young folks. I feel like there's really a lot of young folks here this year. So I wrote a little bit to start here. So in 1997, a man named Michael Goldhaber wrote an article called The Attention Economy and the Net. And in that article, which I recommend that you all read, Goldhaber talks about how attention is today's scarcest resource. And as marketers here, as people in politics, attention is something that we strive every day to gain and to capture, whether it is gaining email addresses, whether it's building a database on a system like Nation Builder, or whether it's ultimately to win votes and to win elections. But it's hard to do in today's day and age. An average person on Facebook has 350 friends. They like over 70 pages, and each one of those friends and each one of those pages is competing for our attention in this room. Attention is dispersed from app to app, from Twitter to Facebook to Tumblr to Reddit, the number 7 most popular site here in Canada, I'm surprised at that, to Instagram, etc., etc. It's dispersed from family to hockey to our jobs to someone's favorite television show. So what can we as conservatives do to actually get someone's attention? I think what we need to do is use tools that get smack in front of voters. Today, I would say the number one tool for that is live streaming video, Facebook Live. So get out your phones, live stream, or buy a camera. There's a really cool camera called the Mevo camera that we use at our company, which can even bring more professional to live streams. The internet is the most trusted source of information when people search about our candidates and our party. So what are you doing in your writings to tell our side of the truth? And remember, Facebook content is not always searchable online. So your content that you're putting on Facebook, you also need to put it on blogs and on Twitter and on your website, even if you're live streaming. Your opinion matters. When I was 14 years old, I started a blog, tooconservative.com, which led me into the career that I'm in now. And I think looking at all of you out there, you all have opinions. You're at this conference. Are you sharing them? Are you sharing your opinions on Twitter, and on blogs. You can create petitions on change.org to push your cause or your issue. You can blend the digital and physical worlds by highlighting young volunteers, taking a page from President Obama, who actually set up a wonderful Tumblr that if you all look at it, it was called Letters to the White House. And he actually photocopied letters that were sent into the White House on this Tumblr page and presented the physical world again in a digital means. When was the last time you proactively searched for a conversation already going on in your writing? Because there's already people in your writings and in your provinces talking about transportation issues, talking about tax issues. When was the last time you proactively went out there and sought to connect with those people and not just waited for them to find you? That's what I would ask you today. You don't need high-paid consultants or Pixar Studios or Hollywood-level production quality videos. Most shared and high-reach types of content on my clients' large Facebook pages are live videos that actually where we printed out pieces of paper and turned over the pieces of paper one by one in long Facebook videos. Because 85%+ of Facebook videos are watched without the sound on. 85%+. Even right now, the people watching this, most of them have their sound off. All right? Hello, turn on your TV. So, how do we as conservatives get someone's attention? Sharing cartoons, sharing listicles, 5 reasons why Justin Trudeau's immigration plan is wrong for Canada. Those are some of the best pieces of content on our Facebook pages. So, I would just end by saying that you all in this audience can create this content. Don't wait for the new leader of the party to do it for you and expect him or her to have all the answers. Don't wait for consultants to do it for you. And that the beauty of digital is that everyone in this room is a content creator, that everyone in this room can generate videos and blogs and policy pieces that can impact elections. So please share your opinions and share them often online and in all those different mediums, and that's going to be helpful. So that's how I start.
Perfect. Exactly on time, too. That's impressive.
Okay.
So we've gathered all this information. We found all these people. We've engaged folks. Now we've got them all in one big pile. My mom and dad used to have index cards, those little recipe-sized cards. And as a kid, I'd have to look up the obituaries and take people out of the index cards so that it was up to date in case there was a by-election. I don't know if anybody else had that routine. So there's a lot better ways to do it than the index card model now. And Nation Builder is one of those places where you get to digitally build a whole community. How do you do that, Sorcha?
Definitely. Firstly, hello everyone, I'm Sorcha. As you can hear, I'm not from Canada or the US. I do live in Los Angeles and work for Nation Builder out of our headquarters there. And to kind of just go back to your original question there around what happened in the US and how they did it digitally with those campaigns, we had 4 out of the 5 major candidates in the general election using Nation Builder. And they did exactly what you were talking about. They pulled in all of their people from Facebook, from Twitter, into a database and were able to engage with that organically. You can look through in your nation and you can see how many people engaged with you and retweeted, how many people have a large following that you could make an ambassador of your campaign. And it's to kind of echo what Vincent was saying there, it's about getting the universe of people that are engaging with you to actually make the content and to, yes, get the message from the campaign, but change it to what they want to feel passionate about and echo that out to their universe of people. The 75 friends that one person has in a small school board race can completely change the message that the school board race themselves brought out by echoing it out to their own universe of people with their own, you know, twist on it. So it's for me, the US election and what they did with digital was really around tapping into the unlikely voters, which we saw the now president of the US do. And it was not going after the historical field game of knocking on doors of people that have historically voted in 4 elections. It was looking at people based on different sets of criteria that you can pull in databases like Nation Builder of their engagement on social media and their engagement with digital. And then personalizing that content with sending out email messages to them that have things that they're interested in. So someone liked something on Facebook, you can literally tell them that back. Hey, saw you engage with this particular issue on Facebook, you know, share it out to the world, be an ambassador of what we're trying to do, as opposed to just going out there and knocking on the door with a less, you know, organic relationship with that person. So yeah.
Excellent. Well, that's building the community. Now, not last but not least, and not least because she's the sponsor of this session.
I appreciate the transparency here.
Well, you know, you've had a career where you've been on the front lines of whatever the new media was, either as talent, behind the camera, out using it for candidates. So you speak, I think, as a practitioner as well as a representative of one organization. It's all moving so fast. How should we be using it in ways that we aren't yet? Or what's the next that we have to wrap our heads around?
It's interesting that you mentioned speed, because that is the opportunity, even though it's the challenge. So for example, right here, we're hearing the snaps of the camera. Jason's taking pictures. And in the past, whether it was a still camera or a video camera, or even if you were writing something, there would be time between that content and getting it somewhere that mattered, whether it was on the media or back to the people you work with. Whereas now, that photo is going directly to the media team over there, and I'll check, but within a couple minutes, we'll have a photo of this panel up at hashtag MCC2017, and then that's gonna go out to the larger audience, which is actually all the people following the hashtag. The larger audience is not in this room. We have people, conservatives across the country, journalists, onlookers, people who just follow the news. That is who you're actually trying to reach. Now, I joined Twitter after 2 decades working in the media, in broadcast, in digital, cross-platform, then in politics last August as the head of news and government. And what a time to join Twitter, because we're in the middle of the US election. And one of our focuses right now has been on video, getting more and more video on the platform. And you'll see that anyone who's looking at a phone is usually in a social app or they're watching video on mute. And more, that's how people are watching TV as well. So you've seen headlines and closed captions as well as social video and how social video is inspiring traditional media. So I was at the first US presidential debate. We teamed up with Bloomberg. We broadcast all 3 presidential debates as well as the VP debate on Twitter, moving away from a second screen experience where you would watch TV and then tweet about it, where you could actually just go on Twitter, watch the debate, hear what people are saying, share your opinion, retweet, whatever the case may be. And then on election day, we teamed up with BuzzFeed for exclusive video coverage. And at Twitter Canada, our office in downtown Toronto, we hosted an election night party with BuzzFeed. And I was on a panel asking questions of a Canadian progressive who had worked on a Democratic campaign, a Canadian conservative who had worked on Republican campaigns, and a journalist. And the consensus of the panel and of the room that night was Hillary Clinton was likely going to be elected president, and we were watching front row the claps of the Republican Party. And around 9 o'clock, everyone realized the opposite was true and that we didn't even know what we were looking at. And I think the best summary I've heard of the US election was that the media didn't take Trump seriously, they took him literally, where his supporters didn't take him literally, they took him seriously. And now, and you see this especially on Twitter, everyone is taking President Donald Trump both literally and seriously. So what I have heard anytime someone hears that I work at Twitter now, Donald Trump, just people bring up Donald Trump. And everything from when are you gonna kick him off the platform to tell me what he's doing. And I'll highlight 3 things that Donald Trump does really well on Twitter, because there was a consensus in the digital community that Barack Obama was the first Twitter president. Mm-hmm. That's actually not the case. Donald Trump has redefined what it means to be a politician on Twitter. So number one, it's him. There was a journalist that actually studied his tweets and figured out that there were 2 different phones, and one of the phones looked like Donald Trump was actually tweeting, and those are the tweets that weren't really on script. And then the other tweets, which were, you know, like typical politicians' tweets, probably approved by 5 different staffers, and were a bit more moderate, that they were coming from a different phone. And then there was this piece of gossip that came out that they took the password for Twitter away from Donald Trump, and then that was part of Barack Obama's stump speech in the last few days. But whether he's actually tweeting on a phone or telling someone what to tweet, it's his voice, and you know that because you can't fake that. That all caps approach, he speaks in all caps, so it's gonna come through like that on Twitter. So whether you're working on a leadership campaign or an issues-driven campaign or you plan to run for office yourself, be on Twitter. Ideally, and staffers hate this, but ideally, it's the candidate or politician actually tweeting, because then you get to connect with constituents directly. That's the best part of Twitter, is that I can have a conversation with a journalist or someone I disagree with, and it's real. We're connecting in a way that we couldn't in real life. Number two, Donald Trump is very strategic when it comes to his use of Twitter. Something he said in 2014, he said, having a Twitter account is like owning the New York Times, except without the losses.
Wow. Well, you bring up the Russians made a lot of information available during this last campaign through WikiLeaks. And if you read through the Hillary Clinton email leaks, there is a period where they debate for 12 hours about what her tweet should be on a $15 minimum wage.
Well, and we've seen that across the board. And number three, what Donald Trump does really well, and this is the rule of all social media, it's not exclusive to Twitter, I think everyone on the panel will agree, don't be boring. That's the number one rule of social media, don't be boring. And politics, to most people, pretty boring.
Well, it brings up this notion of authenticity and voice. So, Vincent, in your campaigns, you know, there used to be a writing room. There used to be, it was one press release was the main artifact for the day, and that was all we were going to distribute, and maybe we were going to speak to that, and it was buffed and edited, and maybe it sounded like the candidate. Maybe you hired a writer because they could do the candidate's voice. Mm-hmm. What's the difference now when we're running a campaign and it's actually the candidate's voice or not?
Well, first off, I don't think every campaign and a lot of our, certainly in the US, a lot of our senators and congressmen, it's still something that they sort of slough off to the staff in a lot of cases. I don't know if you all saw back a year or two ago, there was something that came out that showed that Governor Romney on his presidential campaign had something like 20 people approving each tweet, which of course there's pluses and minuses to that. Regarding authenticity, I think that there's no doubt that when candidates and politicians actually are engaging on these platforms themselves, voters appreciate that. When there are, you know, when there's behind-the-scenes photos, when there's behind-the-scenes videos, when there's tweets on the weekend, because guess what? A lot of staffers don't work on the weekend, so you can tell in a lot of cases that actually is the politician actually being authentic. And, you know, I encourage all of my clients to engage themselves using all of these platforms, but sometimes, obviously, time comes in the way of that, but most politicians, I think, nowadays are increasingly using these tools. And actually, it's been really exciting being here, seeing a lot of y'all's members of parliament tweeting and Facebooking everything themselves.
Saoirse, you know, your platform lets people use different means of a broad bucket of means of communication to communicate with folks. How do you get the voice right? How do you get the authenticity right? How do you do things that will engage people to give money or show up or do things? What are you seeing that's working best in terms of the content that you deploy from the candidate?
Definitely. I think the most important thing about the content from the candidate is actually being original and having a multitude of data sets on each individual person that you are trying to communicate with and making that as personal as you can. And I think we saw in the US that it wasn't about party establishment anymore. It was about the Donald Trumps, the Bernie Sanders of the world, who were authentic, who went out there and gave their message. And it was so obvious to see, like you say, the all caps Donald Trump messages. When you see that from a candidate and you see, it makes them real. It makes them human. It makes them this thing that's like not a shiny presidential object. It's a person that you can relate to and that you can connect with. And I think having that kind of content, whether no matter what medium it is, if it's text messaging, if it's phone banking, Twitter, Facebook, email, making it be real and something that you can connect with a candidate on a human level is what, you know, change what we saw as real in the US elections.
But doesn't this strike fear in the hearts of every campaign staffer in the world when we talk about letting the candidates be themselves?
I think it does, but I also think that there's a lot to be said for having an authentic candidate who can actually own what they're saying, as opposed to having 25 staffers sit in a room to write a tweet or 20 people to approve a tweet.
If I could just add something too. I feel like a lot of times people think more is better, and more isn't always better. Take Senator Paul. Every year, the past few years, he's done an airing of grievances on Twitter, and it's quite humorous if you go and look backwards at some of the things that he's tweeted out. That takes him and his, you know, senior team a lot of time to put that content together. Sometimes actually spending time thinking of what you're going to say, sometimes, you know, being cheeky, even if it takes a few days to think of the exact right thing to say, versus to your point of being boring, that's going to generate a lot more activity. So don't just think because you're tweeting a million times or posting on Facebook a million times every single day that you're doing this right. Sometimes it's about spending more time on a better video or more time on a better piece of content that folks are actually going to enjoy.
Well, so to build on that, before I was working at Twitter, I would often say to my clients, sometimes the best Instagram strategy, insert any platform, is to say, no, we're not going to do it, right? So you have to be strategic in terms of why are you on the platforms. So being on Twitter, that's not a Twitter strategy. That's just creating an account, right? You actually have to think through what the point of it, right? So your larger mission, what the goals are, the strategy, and the tactics. And that's what you do throughout the campaign. You would never send a candidate out just to knock on doors without collecting data, right? So you have to think of how are you using Twitter? Is it to sign up memberships? Is it to frame the conversation? Is it to raise money? Is it get out the vote? It's probably all the above. But I will say, I was just looking at Twitter, and it's funny, the Manning Center tweet, how fast is this for Jennifer Hollett? And it is such a like quick, interesting, dynamic medium that it can be hard to keep up. But again, you can step back and think strategically, what do we actually need to do in this campaign, and how can Twitter or any of the other platforms, and there's probably a new platform being created right now that's going to be relevant in 6 months that we're gonna have to figure out. While that's overwhelming, it's also an opportunity to reach the people that you need to reach to, whether it's form government or win a leadership campaign.
Well, if I'm the traditionalist, and I'm sure there's a few in this room who would call themselves traditionalists, and I say nothing has ever been better than the color-coded map on the wall and the big stack of clipboards and some sharpened pencils, and all of these things you're talking about are just another way to spend money. They're fancy tools of the activist class. Nothing replaces good old-fashioned, you know, clipboards, door-to-door, old-school organizing. What value is the new platform offering in terms of conversion if I'm running an issue campaign, an advocacy group, or a campaign with an election day?
Well, first, you sound like just about every single campaign manager that I've ever met. And I know on my campaign when I ran in the federal election, it's both, right? So the idea that there's this offline world and online world, I think in 2017, it's all the same, right? So if you talk to a young person, and I highly recommend knowing a 15-year-old, whether that's your kid or a cousin, or like for
be
me.
Very careful with that advice, please.
Knowing.
We're talking
knowing,
about legal
knowing,
consensual.
Knowing. To be able to actually say like, hey, like what apps are hot? Yeah. You know, what are you doing on your phone? But if they're actually on WhatsApp chatting with their friends, they would rather hang out in real life, but they can't. They have homework or curfews or have a job, right? So it's not one or the other. That is real life. This is real life, right? This is real life. But of course you have to knock on doors. Absolutely. Yeah. Knocking on doors, that is number one. But in the urban centers where I live in Toronto, it's harder and harder to knock on doors because of condos, because people don't have landlines, they have mobile phones, and it's harder with the air wars to reach them via television because they're cutting their cable cords and they're watching TV on Netflix, right? So this is the opportunity, I think, ideally, face-to-face, whether it's politics or meeting someone new, any type of relationship building is best like this, right? That's why we come to conferences, is to meet people face-to-face, IRL, in real life. But sometimes you can't do that. And that's why it's a complement, it's not a substitute.
They have to go in conjunction. Like, I don't think in this day and age you can have a successful campaign without having a strong field operation and a strong digital operation that are aligned. So that's going on the door and inviting someone to an event and giving them the hashtag you're going to have at the event.
So on Rob Portman's Senate race, which was by most accounts the most successful Senate race in Ohio, we did the digital on that race this past cycle. And when somebody would knock on the door in Ohio, if they didn't get somebody at home, within hours later, as soon as they'd open Facebook, they would see a video from Rob Portman saying that his team was in the neighborhood, that they left literature at the front door, and we would push people to a specific microsite, asking people then if they wanted a yard sign and what issues are most important to them, so that we could still capture data from people who we knew and had identified that weren't at home. So you can definitely blend what's going on online and offline, and you need to be blending that. The reverse is, right, is that when you knock on doors, sometimes it's good to have, I mean, almost every time, it's good to have the information on what's happened online. Taking Nation Builder, what types of Facebook posts are people engaging with online? Wouldn't it be helpful to knock on a door and say, hi, I see that you signed this petition to repeal Obamacare on Facebook. Well, Rob Portman wants to repeal Obamacare. You can do that with a platform like Nation Builder. You can also take information on what people are saying. Let's say that people say in their Twitter profiles, I'm selling your platform now for you. Let's say that people say in their Twitter profiles that they were in the Marine Corps. You could pull that information in through Nation Builder and then knock on someone's door and say, thank you, sir, for your service. How powerful is that? If you can blend all of this together, it takes a lot of time to actually do this right. It does take time to integrate all of these tools. But that's so much more powerful than using Excel spreadsheets over here and then using a clipboard here and then a Facebook account here. And none of it all being.
But Vincent, just to put my traditionalist hat back on to make sure, does that only work in the big campaign that's got six zeros after it in its first draft of a budget? Can I do that in my school board campaign when I've got two volunteers in my dining room table as headquarters?
Yes, you can absolutely do that.
Walk us through some of the examples then, Saoirse. Like, what can I do in the small campaign that, you know, a box of Timbits is our net budget right now?
Yep.
What's that?
Timbit, a Canadian institution. We'll take you for one later.
It's like, hold on. I'm going to translate because half my family's in the U.S. So it's like a donut hole.
Oh, very small.
This is understanding.
Okay.
Very small budget.
Cool. So 100%. On Nation Builder in 2016, we had over 3,000 campaigns. That is, when you break it down, it's like 40% of the people that were on the ballot in 2016. Yes, we did have four of the five presidentials, but the bread and butter of that are school board races. They are water board races, local city council races. Those people can use these platforms just as well. That is one of the mission values of Nation Builder as a company, and personally that I align with very well.
Okay, but I'm an idiot. I open up this platform. Mm-hmm. How do I learn how to use it?
You talk to the help desk, or you go and you study on our support docs. However, it's very user-friendly. You go in and it says, connect your Facebook account. You click the button, it takes you to Facebook, and it connects. And you start to see these people flowing into your nation. Speaking in Nation Builder language now, so I apologize. You start to see these people coming into a database that you can look at, that you can, like Vincent was saying, see, okay, in this person's Twitter bio, they are really interested in repealing Obamacare or whatever it is. You can pull that information in and you can see it. It's a very like user-friendly activity that you can do just by connecting the social media accounts together. And honestly, we've seen that success that you were talking about, Vincent, with the larger campaigns across the board when they're using the tools that Nation Builder provides.
So just to add one further point too, that email might be pretty old as a communications tool now, but every time that we split test social media asks versus email asks, email always does best. So if you're still trying to generate money, if you're trying to generate, bless you, sir, a tesoué, aussi, if you are still, you know, if you're trying to sell product, if you're trying to get people out to go door to door, send them an email. And the same thing with Senator Portman, you can generate emails to be sent and send emails to segments of your list that weren't at the door when you knocked on the door with a survey to still capture data. So don't forget about email. I mean, we talk a lot about social media. It's very important, and we talk about building websites. Email, petitions, polls, surveys. Run them online, get email addresses on issues that are important to you all locally, and then send emails asking for things, because people will take action more via email than they will any other platform.
And on email, and I agree that email is the original social network, you can take email addresses and through a paid campaign insert them into Twitter, and that's really important in a leadership race when you have access to the email addresses of members or new members. So you can connect that to a social campaign to target them with a specific message. And that's the part of, I think, our conversation that we keep coming back to, is that you're building out a larger campaign, right? Not a digital campaign where some young person sits in the back of the room, you don't really know what they're doing, but you know you need to have it. It's actually a campaign where it's all connected.
Now, I grew up with a neighbor who was like an additional, like a surplus grandmother, and very, very good to us, you know, clear-valued, strong woman, very, very religious. I'd never reveal a woman's age, but I'd say she's in her 10th decade now, still with us, doing well. She sent me a friend request on Facebook, and it's now how we communicate, and particularly for photos. So what it's shattering for me is all of my, even if I say, yeah, I know everybody uses these platforms, I still really suspect it's just kids. It's just kids and people who love computers more than everybody else. Where do we have to change our thinking in who's using the platform and who isn't? Who are we missing that we're just not getting through digital right now that we can only get in real life? And who are we forgetting that's there or that's joined and we haven't noticed yet?
So ages 35 to 50 are actually spending more time on certain social platforms now, I believe Facebook even, than people underneath that. So that whole mentality is just out the window. And if we think about it, old people watching Days of Our Lives, do you all have Days of Our Lives? You have
something similar.
We do. Okay.
We had beachcombers.
We can go back now. What's the Days of Our Lives?
Beachcombers, Days of Our Lives, basically.
Okay, yeah. So it's the older people that have less to do, perhaps, who are sitting there watching Days of Our Lives, who are on Facebook all the time. And if you actually looked at the back end of most of our clients' Facebook pages that are very conservative pages, it's actually stair-step up in terms of interaction of age, most of them, which I would almost argue, then how do we reach young people on these platforms? Because they're on these platforms, but they're not engaging with conservative content. So to me, that's a bigger question, is how do we get young people engaged on these platforms? They're clearly on them, but they're off watching cat GIFs and stuff. So how do we get them onto our platform?
You have to do more cat GIFs.
It's an art. Demographics is really important. So in Canada, we know up to 12 million Canadians check Twitter once a month or more. And that's a really high number in a country that has a population of 35 million. But each social media platform is different. So on Twitter, news and politics breaks first. So you can look at any social media platform during or after the Manning Center conference, but the conversation for this conference, the conversation for Canadian politics, hashtag Canadian Poly, is happening on Twitter in a way that it's not on Facebook or on Instagram. Mm-hmm. Doesn't mean you can't use those social media networks in regards to politics, you absolutely can. But it's something to think about in terms of demographics, not just age, but who do you want to reach? So for example, on Twitter, the audience tends to be a more influential audience. The average Twitter user makes more money than, say, the average user on Facebook or another platform. So often, Twitter campaigns are to reach influencers or to reach journalists or to reach politicos specifically. So you want to think not just age in terms of who's on social media, but who's on each platform and what type of messages or engagement are you looking for in that space?
It is different for each platform. And with Nation Builder, you can pull in that information about them on Twitter, where their location is, what that looks like, and then pulling that back out and doing like email acquisition campaigns within Facebook and Twitter to get that information. You have their social media account, but now I really need to talk to them. And you can see that in those email acquisition campaigns where you're pulling in data and you're getting email addresses to these people that you can then be like, okay, I have a universe here of 18 to 30s. I need to now tackle the next step. And how am I going to do that? Which platform makes the most sense to do that? And for the older demographic, it is Facebook as opposed to Twitter.
What about working in different languages? Speaking to new voters from new communities and languages that aren't English. Mm-hmm. How do you use the platform that way, or are we using the digital platforms that way yet?
So that's a great question. I'd say a few things back to that. One is that on Facebook, you can post content on your pages to different languages that people self-identify as when they fill out their Facebook, when they first sign up on Facebook. So if someone says, je parle français, and they sign up, then you can just send content to them in French so that you don't look like an idiot sending them content in English. The same goes with any other language. And actually, I think you'd be surprised that some of the sort of more minor languages on some of our clients' pages, Portuguese, Spanish, some of these other languages that if we really had time and folks to create that content, it's obviously better to produce content in those native languages. It gets harder for me on some of the other platforms. Take Twitter, and I don't know your thoughts on it, but the Pope, for example, I think he's got a bunch of different Twitter accounts in a bunch of different languages. So do you tweet in multiple languages from one account, which I've seen some people here do? Do you get different accounts? It's offensive to me. I'm a big Speak English in America guy. So it's offensive to me when people are speaking Spanish. Maybe not offensive, just annoying. Maybe both, okay? So I prefer our politicians talking in English to us, which we speak English in America. So when a politician puts something in English and then in Spanish to me, I click unfollow pretty friggin' quick. So that's a very good question, and it's one that doesn't have a very easy answer.
So on Twitter, we have a feature that actually translates the language for you, and that's done by volunteers around the world, which is pretty incredible. So anytime you see a tweet in a language that you don't understand, personally, I look at languages like music, right? And I think it's a beautiful sound. And there's the opportunity if you don't understand, especially if you're looking to follow, let's say, an election in another country, right? Or tap into a community. But back to your original question, I think what you always have to do, especially in a local race, is ask that community which social media platform you're on. Because they might say, no, we read like the local paper that is written by someone in our community. Or they might say, we're on Weibo, or we're on WhatsApp. But ask them, because it's different. So for example, the diaspora might be using a different social media platform than folks back in the country they come from. So, and it's always changing too, because I know, working for a Chinese Canadian candidate, we were trying to tap into the very large Chinese community, and young people who immigrated from China at, say, University of Toronto, they're using social media very differently than their friends back home, than their parents. Mm-hmm. So it depends where you live, your age, and that's why I think you always have to check. You need to know your constituents.
I think the way you do this, though, tells a lot about who you are as a candidate, right? I mean, this is maybe the very conservative in me coming out, but this is a very good question, right? I mean, certainly in the States, there's always a discussion in Republican primaries on, do you put Spanish on a website? Do you just have it in English? Do you have the Spanish button? Do you pretend you know Spanish and try to learn three things, right? I mean, that's a serious question. And Donald Trump sort of wiped away a lot of that, though. I mean, he wiped away that.
Eating one taco bowl. One taco bowl.
We have a large customer base in Latin America, and using the social media tools, it really is. It's all about knowing your constituents and engaging with them, meeting them at the level that they're at. And it definitely is amazing to use the tools are available on Facebook and Twitter when someone writes something in English to be able to hit the button and say see translation. I definitely am in the same vein as you. Different languages is music to my ears, so I can't say I unfollow when someone posts in Spanish. I'm intrigued to understand what it is.
So one more thing on that too. When I was working on the digital campaign of Prime Minister Netanyahu, we would post things to people that self-identified as speaking English just in Israel on his page too, and then Russian, and then Hebrew, and then French. But those tools aren't always 100% correct, especially when it comes to people self-identifying as speaking English. So here you could get into trouble in Quebec, for example, because people might speak French first, but they might have accidentally signed up in English. And it was offensive to some people. They would get offended if you were sharing something in Hebrew, sorry, in English, but they spoke Hebrew. So here, I mean, I can only imagine this. I already know the sensitivities here of French and English. So I would just be very careful and maybe test a couple times using these tools and just realize that you're not going to, nothing online is truly hidden. So if you're going to say something in French, it's probably going to be out there at some point to folks in English too.
The great sociologist Woody Allen once said that dying is easy and comedy is hard. You know, you talk about getting people's attention. We talk about the balance of trying to compete with a cat GIF. Mm-hmm. The tool a lot of people want to use is funny, but funny's hard. Where's the line? Who's doing it well? And what are the things you should never, ever do?
Yeah, I think it's painful to watch anyone who's trying to be a comedian, whether that's on Twitter or at the office or in the classroom, right? You know, that person who's like worked on their jokes all night.
I take that. And
they don't quite land them. I think it's most important to be honest and sincere.
Okay.
And I think with honesty, often there's humor. And that was something I really enjoyed in the leadership debate yesterday. There were some just like nice, honest moments, and the crowd laughed. And it was just very much in the moment. And especially on Twitter, it's what's happening in the moment. Yeah. So often, what gets retweeted or sparks a conversation is a hashtag or a reaction to something that's happening in the news. Not that someone's planned out or is deliberately trying to be funny, but it's just something that they reacted to and other people connected with. So be true to who you are, who your candidate is, the personality of your campaign, because if you try too hard, social media doesn't like that.
100%.
Well, Vincent, you raised the issue of the infamous Rand Paul Festivus Twitter festival. How did they come up with that? And is there a danger when you have a very serious person in a very serious job being irreverent in one of their official communications channels?
So I don't think there's danger in that at all if it's done properly and if you plan for it. That's why I was saying that they plan that out, and the senator comes up with, you know, a lot of those ideas, and some of his senior staff comes up with some ideas, and it's all planned out. And if you do something like that, and you have a day or two of really sort of sexy, interesting, pithy, funny content, you can use that to grow your social channel. So I would say it's the opposite of dangerous. It's very helpful if you actually do that properly. Or, you know, good organic content is always better than crappy content that you have to pay, right? So if you're actually spending time and you're producing something that's interesting and unique, I don't think it always needs to be funny. I think it's more important that it's delivered, though, in the soundbite digital way. This is the third time that I've mentioned this study now, but there's a wonderful study that Microsoft Canada did talking about attention spans here in Canada. You all should read about it. And in the study, it shows the average human attention span is 8 seconds. The average attention span of a goldfish is 9 seconds. So the summary of the study is we have less attention span than a goldfish. So, which is sad, right? Very, very sad. So how do we then, you know, make sure that somebody sees what we're saying? It doesn't necessarily have to be funny. Not everything Donald Trump says is funny, to your point. It's not funny. Some people think it's funny, but not all.
Good soup is an example.
It's not always funny.
It's good soup. Campbell's soup, yep, the executive from Campbell's Soup introduced herself.
Oh, yeah.
He said, good soup. It's good soup. But it was a funny moment because there was something just honest and surprising.
What's going on? I'm lost.
Oh, okay. So the other day in a business panel,
yeah,
the head of Campbell's Soup introduced herself, and he said, good soup. And everyone was laughing. There was all these memes around this comment, good soup. Mm-hmm. But I don't think he was trying to be funny.
Yeah.
It was just a surprising moment for the president to say, good soup.
Yeah.
What's the good soup people are using in nation builder campaigns to get people's attention?
Oh, so I don't
I don't think that there is a plan around things like good soup. I think it's something that happens organically in the moment. I think that there are things that happen, like what you just described there, where there are campaigns that plan out to make this kind of look organic and have that moment. But I think the best ones, the good soups of the world, are organic and they happen in the moment.
And if you are confident that your candidate or the MP that you're working with can actually land something or pull off an irreverent piece of content, retweet a supporter or a constituent or take it from your base. Because there are incredible memes that surface, not from the official campaigns or you know, not from the offices, but a retweet or having fun or just showing that, you know, you can laugh at yourself. That goes a long way.
So to give you one example that I'm thinking of here that made me laugh, we were working for a conservative party in Spain at the last election called Vox. And Vox made issue with the fact that Gibraltar is still owned by England. So one of the gentlemen, excuse me? Oh, one of the, are you a Vox supporter, sir?
No.
Okay.
I believe in Gibraltar being British.
Okay. So one of the folks on our campaign went over into Gibraltar. He put out a huge Spanish flag to generate attention. And we alerted the press to it. It was all over social media. I believe he got arrested, and we started the hashtag Free Nacho, because the gentleman's name was Nacho. So that's a way to use press attention and to use social media and to actually spark something like that that'll sort of go viral online. So,
what about when you make a mistake?
Free Nacho.
I always love the famous tweet when Chancellor of the Exchequer Ed Balls opened up his Twitter account and tweeted Ed Balls, which I believe has been retweeted hundreds of thousands of times now. And some candidates, of course, accidentally tweet other things that cause other problems. Mm-hmm. How do you fix a social media mistake? What do you do when you posted something you shouldn't have? And I'm not referring to something salacious. I'm referring to it wasn't right for the moment, the context is wrong, we fired a little too quickly. Is it okay to delete things?
You have to own it, because there are journalists and people on Twitter who are screen grabbing your accounts, right? People are watching it all the time. So if someone on Twitter sees a tweet that raises their eyebrows, they're going to screen grab it, right?
So there's no 5-second rule. Like when I drop a French fry on the floor.
Not much. Nope. Yeah, no, it's not like the 5-second rule. So I think you have to own it. And Vincent, this is something that you had mentioned in your session earlier today. Gone are the days where you just pretend there isn't a problem, you pretend there isn't an attack. And I think when you come forward and you speak to what everyone else is talking about, that's probably your best approach. But of course, there's an opportunity to pivot or reframe, and that's on social media and traditional media. You know, that tactic still exists. But if there's a conversation happening and it's about you, you should be part of it in a proactive way.
So one of the most stressful days of my life, I accidentally tweeted on behalf of the Lieutenant Governor of Texas his support for gay marriage, and he supports traditional marriage. It was moments after a Supreme Court decision in Texas, and I said, marriage equals one man and one man, and I meant one man and one woman.
How did you pivot that?
My next sentence was worse. It said, the silent majority is with us, favor it if you agree. I had to call the Lieutenant Governor and I said, sir, I have some bad news. He said, well, can't you just delete it? No one would ever know. I said, sir, I think it's out there, sir. So I did keep my job somehow, but so we ended up blaming it on a fictitious intern. So what we did was 15 minutes later, we said, sorry about that. Of course, I support traditional marriage. And and you can send in your resumes for our new internship opening here.
Wow.
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 So that's one way to own it, I guess.
Wow. Wow.
So you've all talked about the need to get people's attention, the increasing
need.
That's
how you do it.
Yeah. That's
I mean, that got my attention. The need to get people's attention, you're competing with so many other things in a fractured media environment, in a fractured communications environment, so it could be a cat gif, it could be just someone being busy in their life.
Are we telling our candidates to behave poorly to get attention? Are we ratcheting it up or sending the wrong message to erode the office, their brand, by performing and entertaining too much as opposed to informing?
I think it's important to know, and this was advice I was given by many people when I decided to run for office, you need to know why you're running. And that applies not just to the candidate or someone seeking re-election, but to everyone volunteering on the campaign. Why are you doing this? Most people don't spend their evenings talking to strangers about politics, right? So if you're involved with a campaign, you're in this room, that's a values-driven decision. I think it's really important, even if you're looking for a GIF or, you know, you want to do something that trends, that you never abandon the values that motivated you to get involved in the first place. You have to be true to the values and the whole point of your campaign.
Yeah. Okay.
I don't think anyone is in this background telling people to do things that will ultimately demean an office. I think in the case of the now president, I think it's very, as we're aware, it's him in the moment and the things that he wants to say. And I think it's hard coming from working on lots of campaigns to control a candidate if that's how they want to react and engage with people. So
I would say the old playbook is gone. And I wish, look, we're all intellectuals here, spending our Saturdays here, but that's not how people use the internet, is to watch 15-minute speeches on carbon taxes and everything you all were talking about yesterday. My God, there were some words that were mentioned. I didn't even know some of the bills that were being referenced. And you know, it was interesting sitting over there watching the whole debate, because I was sitting here thinking, I don't know what some of these people are saying. So do the 80,000 members, probably, are the 80,000 people that are going to vote? No, but I don't even think all of them know what some of these people are actually saying up here. So how do we dumb down carbon taxes? I'll tell you, some people did a great job of that. Kevin O'Leary did a wonderful job, I think, of getting those sound bites and simplifying message. In 8 seconds of attention span, less than a goldfish, right? How do you do that? How do you do that without demeaning the office? That's what's tough, right? I do think we've gone so far this way in some things some people in America that will go unnamed are doing, right? So how do we still talk about sound policy? Okay, maybe it's different platforms and different mediums, right? Maybe we have a policy blog that we talk in long form content and that we deliver that content, and that's different than what we tweet, and that's different than what we Facebook Live, and that's different than what we email. It's gonna be a pain to do all these things differently. Certainly it was a lot easier when you just went on local news and you did one or two interviews, but that's not the case anymore. So I don't see this as demeaning, and one of my favorite examples of this is, one of my clients is the oil and gas industry, and we have to take their issues, which some of them are pretty complicated, setbacks, drilling, fracking, you know, water stuff. There are so many different issues. We created this website, frackfeed.com, where we're simplifying a lot of that message into cheeky memes. So check out the stuff that we're doing on FrackFeed, because I think that that'll show you how to take some complex issues and yet simplify them. If you're not simplifying and you're still talking over people's heads, you might as well be talking with the sound off, because it doesn't matter.
And you can also do both. So you can have an engaging tweet that links off to a PDF, because especially in a leadership race where you're connecting with members, there are going to be members who want to do a deep dive. There are a lot of you in this room. You're going to want to read all the PDFs of all the different campaigns. And again, that's just the type of people who get involved politics at this level. So you can do that, but you can also bring in the average person who's really busy working two jobs, you know, raising three kids, and you know, surfing around late at night just for a good laugh, to capture his or her imagination as well.
Okay, I want to go back office for a second. We've been talking about the front office presentation of using these digital tools. I hear the word analytics, and I start to get the same flop sweats I used to get in calculus. I don't have that brain. I'm not good at thinking that way. But if I'm running a campaign, the dining room table campaign,
What's the data that I'm getting on the back end of the site that I can use to power decisions about getting more voters or choose what's working or what's not? And I'll ask each of the three of you to give an example. I'll go with Twitter, Nation Builder, and then Vincent, whatever tool you want to profile. So what about all this data and all this analytics I hear about? How do I use it when I'm not a propeller head and a statistician?
Yeah, so you know, the simplest way to look at data, and you can think of small data instead of big data,
is
see what works, right? So on Twitter, you can look at the analytics of your tweets at the bottom of each tweet and also within the site. But if something's being retweeted, if something's getting a lot of likes, if you're seeing a high percentage of engagement, just stop and say, why this tweet,
okay,
right? Why this tweet? What's going on here? And is there a message that we can then put into a speech? Is there something that we can carry over to an email when we ask for money? Like, what's going on here? And I think too often you have someone, and you might not if it's a kitchen table campaign, and I think most campaigns start at the kitchen table still. I don't think that's changed. But you might not, you know, have a data person, or if you do, they're doing their own thing and they're not actually communicating with the campaign manager and the field organizers. So what you want to do is you want to look for lessons in something that is doing well or something that is not, and figure out what's going on and try
whose job is that? Like, is that one person now that where I used to decide I have these four people and that was the those were the pillars of a campaign, I now need one person just looking at this, or is this everybody's job? How does that work?
Well, I always encourage volunteers on a campaign, even on their Twitter accounts, to figure out what works and what doesn't work. And that's what's so fun about Twitter is you can just be like an average Canadian, but you have a voice in Canadian Poly because you're figuring out what works, how to get into the top tweets, how to get something trending. So the best part of digital is you can experiment and actually see what works.
Now this, I may be too ignorant. Do you want to explain to people what Canadian Poly is?
Oh, sure. So hashtag Canadian Poly, and that's a great question. For those of us who are on Twitter, that's how you can follow what people are saying in Canadian politics. And then it could be ON Poly or another hashtag on your province. And then usually the local city politics have a hashtag. And then often during an election, the riding will have a hashtag as well. So it's an opportunity to follow a conversation that relates to a location, you know, whether that is a city, province, or country.
Okay, Sorsha, Nation Builder's aggregating all of this data on people. It's putting it all in one place for me. What do I have to learn from it? Where are the analytics that I, as a dumb guy, who doesn't know how to work this thing yet, I've only had the YouTube training and the help desk support that you directed me to.
Yeah.
What data am I getting that's going to drive my decision making?
Okay. So in Nation Builder, there are a number of different analytics that you can look at. Email stats, your social media, Facebook likes, Twitter likes, and going back to like the bios, as well as the following. And it's a combination of all of them, so coordinating them all. So when you come in and you've sent out 7 tweets and kind of like an A-B testing almost of like what content works.
Does everybody know what A-B testing is? Can you define that for us?
So testing 2 messages that work, and then whichever works, sending the rest of that message out to that universe.
Yeah, and I think the best way to look at A-B testing is to send out an email with 2 different subject lines.
Yeah.
So the emails are the same, but you might have a higher open rate with one.
And that is a functionality that's available in Nation Builder. But to get back to kind of like what you do with those analytics, so you send out 7 tweets, and you have filters that you'll run within your account within Nation Builder that's going to pull that data for you. So you can see of those 7 tweets, one of them did really well. One of them actually had 79 retweets. Why is that? Looking at that content saying, what does this mean? And then from there, putting that into an email ask, putting that into a petition page, like whatever that means, that content, and sharing that out with the world. The other side of Nation Builder, that to go to that like social media ambassador aspect, is using recruiter links.
What's
so
that?
To explain that, excuse me, if I send out a tweet from my own personal account, I can get a recruiter link from my Nation Builder that I will get credit if Jennifer goes and clicks on that link. So when you come back into the account, you can see Sorsha, from the tweet that she shared about your campaign, about your nonprofit, you can see that Sorsha's recruited Jennifer and Vincent and everyone in this room. And so that comes back to individual analytics. So I can see my top 10 people in my campaign.
Then we could make them compete.
Yes, you can. Ooh, with leaderboards.
Market incentives.
That's
I like this.
Another function in Nation Builder. You have a leaderboard of the people who are recruiting the most people. So yeah, lots of different analytics capabilities.
Vincent, you spend a lot of money, a lot of campaign and candidates' money. What's the data that you use that drives the important choices you make about where to deploy time, people, and money.
So in the States, there are two major data companies. One of them is called i360, and the other is called Data Trust. And they, most big campaigns, create some sort of arrangement with either of those companies. And those companies will provide the actual base voter file. They'll create some sort of voter model based on past turnout, based on who the individual candidate is. And then we will use that as a base data set from which to actually target ads to. For everybody here in the room that's trying to look at social analytics, there's two tools that I like. One's called Sprinklr, and then the other's called the Nuvi app. So if you look at those two tools, they're both affordable. I think Sprinklr's like spelled like Sprinklr without an E, and then Nuvi app. And some of
So just because we have a lot of people following online, watching on Facebook Live and using the on Twitter through the MC2017 hashtag, I'm going to ask crowdsource either someone here in the audience to aggregate this as part of our conversation so that people have homework to follow up on.
Cool.
So Nuvi app. Mm-hmm. Sprinklr, if people could post links, if they could find them.
Yeah.
Any other tools that are on your desktop that don't cost, $1 million to use that everybody should be using if they're a digital campaigner?
Well, I mean, everybody should be using Google Analytics and should be spending time to connect Google Analytics through to your donation pages. There's an e-commerce side of Google Analytics, which is really cool. And if you actually spend time in analytics looking at individual pages on your website, what types of content that people are consuming, how they're getting to your website, where they're exiting from. There's a lot of information there that's helpful. And you can connect analytics to your social accounts now, to your AdWords, to your YouTube. So if you're doing all of that, that's going to give you for folks running for city council. If you're really making sure that everything's connected into that, that should be really helpful.
Any reading or anything that you follow? If I'm sitting at home, I've got the dining room table campaign in its nascent stage, where should I be going for good resources to learn, videos, content, talking to other people who are starting out?
So I'd read TechCrunch.com, I'd read Mashable.com, I'd read Recode, which is really cool. That's a good site out of California. And then there's a lot of resources. There's a group called Lincoln Labs that I'm an advisory member on, or I think it's just called Lincoln now, or Lincoln Networks. They've changed their name. If you Google them, they have a lot of resources on their website for campaigns. There's just a whole lot of information about analytics, about social media. So if you Google Lincoln and you go to their website, Garrett Johnson and Aaron Jin are the heads of it, and they have a conference too in California every year where they bring out some of the tech folks, so that could be something good for you all to be.
I also recommend, whether it's in the US or now in France or in another riding, following all the campaigns within a campaign, so all the different candidates, doing that on Twitter, doing that via email, or just across the board with other social media platforms. Because usually, especially in the US for us Canadians, where you have the money and you have Silicon Valley, it's a good way to see, okay, these are the trends. We're probably going to see them in Canada in a couple years. But by actually just following some of the best practices. And then if you're overwhelmed when the campaign's done, you can unsubscribe and unfollow. But to actually see campaigns as they're unfolding, because they are testing.
Yeah. Well, we get to learn from that. There's a functionality in Nation Builder that you can pull in the followers of all of the other campaigns that are running in your race. And there are a number of different use cases for this, but predominantly in the political space, it's used for opposition marketing. So you're gonna pull in the Twitter following of someone who's running in your leadership race, and you will target your ads at their followers. And you'll be able to see from the data that you're getting back in Nation Builder who's engaged with that.
Okay, Saoirse, we go steal your laptop right now. We somehow figure out the password. What are the apps or the sites or the tools you're using to help people succeed on Nation Builder or in digital campaigning?
Totally. I'm going to be like an ad for Nation Builder.
Okay.
I use Nation Builder solely, and Nation Builder uses Nation Builder to run Nation Builder.
Okay.
It's a very full cycle. But in terms of like engaging with content for strategy, campaigns and elections is a Facebook group. They actually do, think it's Mondays, they do a Facebook Live where it's talking about strategy and digital strategy in particular. Okay. So I would 100% recommend checking out Campaigns and Elections, and it really is all about that kitchen table kind of startup of your campaign.
Okay, Jen, we break into your laptop. Yes. What tools are you using other than Twitter?
Sure.
I know you're using Twitter first.
Absolutely. So I'd say one of the simplest tools that I use, you know, aside from, of course, you know, Google Chrome and Twitter and reading some of the blogs that were just mentioned, something as simple as a screen grab, for example. So someone who's doing an incredible job right now on Twitter covering the Trump administration is Daniel Dale of the Toronto Star. And part of that is, I think, he spent a lot of time covering Toronto Mayor Rob Ford and then went on to this assignment. But it's like how he's using screen grabs, for example. So he'll do a screen grab on his phone or of an article that he's written in Word. It's not high technology at all, but that's going to perform better in a tweet than just linking off to the article. So that's one of the best things to think about when you're developing a digital strategy is what is going to perform well on Twitter, and that's different than what's going to perform well on Facebook. It's different than what's going to perform well on Instagram. It's different than what you're going to write in a press release. And I know that sounds like a lot of work, but when you take the time to actually be a part of these spaces and communities, you're going to see a return on investment. So some of the tools would be as simple as getting to know the camera on your phone and how to shoot and how to edit. So I think the tools that I use are not very sexy or expensive, but it's like very much those kind of quick grassroots hacks that help you create content quickly. Because especially on Twitter and the work that we do, you're often tweeting from a phone that's running out of battery juice at a conference like this, and you're trying to create a tweet that will actually connect. In doing that, it's going to be through a screen grab or a photo or something really simple.
The greatest respect to our hosts and producers here to stay on time. I'm going to ask if anyone has questions in the room or online watching that they put them on the live feed that's on Facebook or on the hashtag MC2017. We'll reach out and try and get you answers either
MCC.
From the training.
MCC2017,
I apologize. MCC2017 is the hashtag. So if someone could check the other hashtag and redirect everybody, I'd appreciate it. I want to thank our three panelists, Vincent, Sorsha, and Jennifer for giving of themselves and their expertise.